on behalf of National Institute of Advanced Studies and the Foundation for Good Governance based in Delhi, let me warmly welcome you for this evening discussion on a very interesting subject. We started a new initiative within the Institute. We call it as International Peace Research Initiative. The focus of that initiative was we would speak about global peace, what's happening in South China Sea, what's happening in Africa, what's happening in Middle East. Then the second idea was we will speak about regional peace within South Asia, what's happening in Sri Lanka, India, Pakistan. And then we also said we'll also talk about national peace, the Maoist region, JNK, Northeast. And then when we were discussing this sometime, Mr. Karthikeyan said, all this is fine. What about peace from inside? What about peace from within? That you will never be able to achieve national, regional, and global peace unless you are at peace with yourself. I really like that idea that, you know, we cannot just talk about peace outside without talking about peace inside. So the idea of an inner peace, and then this can't be just spoken in one single day with one single issue. From mind to heart, there is so much that we may want to discuss. So when I spoke with Mr. Karthikeyan about we doing a series, Mr. Karthikeyan has been doing a series of events on this areas in Delhi. So when I asked him, can we do something like this at NIAS in Bangalore, he welcomed the idea. And then, you know, with his great support, and then I went to the director and I asked him, sir, can we do something like this? And then I kind of cautioned him, we have not done something like this in NIAS. Then he said, that is why, precisely why we should do it at NIAS. I thank you for that encouragement, sir. So here we are. We have two speakers. I'll request Mr. Karthikeyan to introduce later. We'll start with two opening batsmen. We have them here. The way we would do it is, I'll request my director, Professor Shailesh Nayak, to welcome you formally. And then Mr. Karthikeyan would introduce both the speakers, and both would speak for 30 minutes each, and then we'll have enough time for discussion. They said that both the speakers have promised that they would not leave the hall until they answered the last person standing in the hall. That shows the commitment that they have. Now with that, a small introduction, may I request all four of you to take the seats here, and I'll request Professor Nayak to welcome the gathering and also welcome the team. Following Professor Nayak's welcome note, Mr. Karthikeyan will introduce the speakers.
Sri Karthikeyan ji, Dr. Arul, Dr. Manickam, Professor Suba, distinguished guest, ladies and gentlemen, I'm really very happy to welcome you all to a very interesting talk, and especially Karthikeyan ji and Dr. Arul and Dr. Manickam. They have taken trouble from all the way to come different places, Delhi, Chennai, and be with us. It's very interesting series which has been started, and I really compliment Subha to think over, thought over, and Dr. Karthikeyan, who also said that we should do this. I think the importance is many such things Dr. Karthikeyan has been doing in Delhi. But I think now many things he would like to do also in Bangalore, and particularly in NIAS with us. So I'm really very happy, and we definitely ensure you that we would be definitely willing to support whatever the work you have been doing. With this, I again welcome you all, and I hope that we will have extremely good discussion at the end of this talk. Thank you.
Namaskar. Good evening to all of you. This campus has always been a favorite of mine. Of course, we go all over the country, all over the world, but I find this has some unique vibration, both inside the building and outside. The moment I come, I go for a long walk into the forest. Thanks to the Tatas, we are still having this, you know, they could not encroach upon this campus. We enjoy the beautiful ambience. Dr. Subha Chandran has also been a part of my organization, Foundation for Peace, Harmony and Good Governance, which we began in Delhi about 15 years back. And we have been having almost every month a talk program, sometimes seminar, sometimes whole day conferences also. We would have done about 150 such things on all possible subjects on the planet, even in the space and all that. And we had a good fortune of getting eminent personalities, including Dr. Abdul Kalam, and the most eminent scientists, jurists, philosophers, religious leaders, and willingly part. And then audience goes unpredictable in Delhi. Sometimes the hall is full, overflowing. We have to get the chairs from outside. Sometimes it's not so. But anyhow, every program is recorded, edited, and put on the website. So thousands around the world have had the opportunity and have had access to it. And many have written how some of the programs have changed their lives also. And we are launching the first program today. Now, why should we choose this subject? Who is not concerned with health? Quoting Buddha, health is the greatest gift, contentment the greatest wealth, truthfulness the best relationship. That's how Lord Buddha gave all importance to health. According to him, to enjoy good health, to bring true happiness to one's own family, to bring peace to all, one must first discipline and control one's own mind. If a man can control his mind, he can find the way to enlightenment, and all wisdom and virtue will naturally come to him. Joyce Meyer, American charismatic author and speaker, I quote her, "It is so important to realize that every time you get upset, it drains your emotional energy." We all know that. "Losing your cool makes you tired. Getting angry a lot messes your own health." Only one more quote. Thomas Jefferson, American president, statesman, and author. "Our greatest happiness does not depend on the condition of life in which chance has placed us, but it is always the result of your good conscience, your good health, occupation, and freedom in all just pursuits." We all know about Nature Cure. Nature Cure Hospital at Dharamsala says big, bold letters, "Food is medicine." If we eat the right food at the right quantity at the right time and have some reasonable exercise, you are assured of perfect health. You will not fall ill. If you fall ill, you recover fast, and we live as long as we are destined to live happily and go peacefully. Nature Cure or natural care refers to methods of self-healing, often using fasting, dieting, rest, hydrotherapy, etc. It's a science of natural healing in which natural measures are used for preventing, curing, treating, and managing all diseases. Originally, it is pure ancient Ayurveda, the science of life without potent medicines. It is an easier form of Ayurvedic therapies. Ayurveda says, when diet is correct, there is no need of any medicine. If the diet is wrong, there is no medicine that can provide relief. So, food is used as medicine. But I believe, and here all the speakers also believe, in not just alternative system, or we believe in integrative health. Integrative medicine is healing-oriented medicine that takes account of the whole person, including all aspects of lifestyle. It emphasizes the therapeutic relationship between practitioner and the patient, is informed by evidence, and makes use of all appropriate remedies. The most essential principle of integrated medicine is patient and practitioner are partners in the healing process. All factors that influence health, wellness, and disease are taken into consideration, including mind, spirit, and community, as well as the body. So appropriate use of both conventional and alternative methods facilitates the body's innate healing response. Effective interventions that are natural and less invasive should be used wherever possible. Integrative medicine neither rejects conventional medicine nor accepts alternative therapies uncritically. So good medicine is based on good science. It is inquiry driven and open to new paradigms. Alongside the concept of treatment, the broader concepts of health promotion and the prevention of illnesses are paramount. So practitioners of integrative medicine should exemplify its principles and commit themselves to self-exploration and self-development. So why we thought of this subject and why thought of these eminent speakers today is, a few months back, I happened to meet lot of people and who have been suffering from cancer or liver-related diseases, acute form. Some of them have gone through chemotherapy and all that in well-known hospitals. And they were told, you have got just 3-4 months to live. And they happened to come across this miracle, healing miracle therapy. And I saw them telling that we have been here last 1 month, we have been improving. Somebody said in 3 months we are totally recovered, we are gone. And someone, he said he had a throat cancer. They thought it's incurable. And they said everything is done. But then like you hear him, I also heard about them. I met them. That gentleman said, sir, in 3 weeks time of healing through this therapy of vitamin C and ozone therapy, 3 weeks it came out itself. He showed they are taken photograph also. I heard it from the man. I have no reason to disbelieve him because I know him also. So I, like all of us, you know, I was hesitant. But I met number of such people and I had a lot of discussions with them. I thought it's time we bring out. By word of mouth, people go there. I thought we should inaugurate this series here by bringing these two eminent personalities and hear from them. Even if some of us get benefited and very spreading the word, I am immense. Even if one or two persons are benefited, we are immensely pleased. Dr. Manickam is a well-known industrialist, Shakti Group of Industries in Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. There was also industries in America and all that. And just to put it very briefly, turnover of $1.2 billion, 40,000 employees, managing 30 educational institutions with 30,000 students, involved also in education of especially hearing disabled and blind since the last 20 years. He has dedicated his life for health and healing of people with treatments based on nature and alternative and complementary medical options. Mirakle Wellness Foundation, he is supporting it. And he wants to see people who are given up or even who are suffering seriously get well soon at nominal cost, 1/10 of, and then sure. And even the last 12, 15 years, along with managing his huge industrial empire, he has been treating people with vitamin C, and I heard yes, very, very senior officer telling that they got total recovery vitamin C alone. And I happened to meet Dr. Arul, who is an eminent allopathic doctor, who specialized in various therapies and all that. He says, these complementary therapies began his interest after his firm conviction for conventional medicines or therapies. They have a limited solution for patients suffering from coronary diseases. A co-founder of New Life Wellness Center in Chennai has brought miraculous results to patients by employing integrative medicine, even treating successfully serious cancer and liver illnesses. First person to bring the extracorporeal blood ozonization and oxygenation therapy to India. First person in India to start hyperbaric ozone therapy after undergoing training from the inventor, Dr. Johan Ledoni. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to stand between you and them, but only accepting an appeal, please take them seriously and listen to them. Believe what they say, because I believe them. And I don't endorse somebody unless I am convinced about their genuineness. It's only for your benefit. And also, they also want to spread this knowledge. We can see within 12 to 24 months of this time, you'll see already there is a big queue, only by word of mouth. So I told them, well, mostly he does in Madras very limited facilities, But thanks to Dr. Manickam's generosity, they opened in 45 days a beautiful facility in Pollachi. Pollachi near Coimbatore, I'm sure you know very well. I said, but where will people stay? Now they tell me they have already created 4 rooms and 4 rooms are full. And the 7-story building, obviously, Dr. Manickam says, I will provide the whole 7-story building to this. I said, how are you going to manage the rest of people who are going to come? But they are, he has got knowledge, he has the faith, and he has got the resources. Between them, you will see, he is going to be spread all over the country very soon. You are one of the fortunate first people to hear them formally making this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the kind introductions. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a privilege to be here. And you know, this campus has so much for all of us in the national mainstream. So many ideas have come out of here. So I'm happy that you know we're able to introduce a concept, and hopefully some of the scientists here look at it, and you probably will be able to advance it much more than what we can. I mean, I've just got Alfred Einstein here. We talk about cancer today. If somebody gets cancer, it's a punishment of death. It's a matter of time. You've gone on to the death row. You don't know when the Supreme Court is going to say go. So until your appeal in the Supreme Court is heard, you're waiting. It could be a matter of time. And that's the kind of feeling that we have. If I'm not mistaken, some years back, we thought about tuberculosis like that. Okay, and we thought about leprosy like that. And now nobody talks about tuberculosis being a major disease, leprosy being a major disease, but cancer is a disease which has been there. Is it possible that we can cure cancer? Our belief, Dr. Arul and I, we firmly believe it's easier than most other diseases. Unfortunately, what has happened is that we have not devoted our attention into the basic reason for cancer and how it can be set right. We're only looking at the symptoms and not at the roots. So I'd like to just carry on and show you what we have. If you look at the world, after 1945 is when explosion of new technologies came in, after the Second World War. And if you look at the heart diseases, and I'm just taking two date points, 1950 and 2005. It's not changed too much after that. If you look at cardiac disease, from 600 per 100,000, we've been able to reduce it to 211, almost to one third. Similarly, on cerebrovascular diseases, from 180, it's down to 46, almost one fourth. And influenza pneumonia, from 48 to 20, about half. Look at cancer, from 193 to 183. Hardly any reduction in deaths due to cancer over the last 55 years. In spite of the fact that maximum effort has been put into cancer, so much of research, you have PET scans, you have proton beams, you have electron beams, you know, you name it. They have all kinds of fancy technologies, but our death rate is still kind of remain at the same level. And also, I want to talk about chemotherapy. Okay, this is the first line of defense that we have today against cancer. And when we go as non-conventional health providers to the patients, the first comment we got from the doctors, have you got data to prove what you're doing? Have you been FDA approved? I have a problem with the FDA because they're not really, Federal Drug Authority of India. They're basically America. So, you know, half of your Unani, Siddha, and Ayurveda would be banned in the US. So we have all these cliches coming in. So we said, okay, let's look at what is modern medicine done. Let's look at the track record of chemotherapy. If you look at this, this is a paper presented in 1992 on chemotherapy. They were taken 3,000 researchers and looked at it. There's no direct evidence that chemotherapy prolongs a life of a cancer patient, which is unbelievable. We are spending millions of rupees, lakhs of rupees. Sometimes one chemo costs you 10 lakhs of rupees, right? But there's no evidence that it cures cancer. And also, secondly, you talk about reaction, you know, to a therapy. If I do a therapy, if I do radiation, the cancer burns. I can see it burn. And the PET scan, I can see it going down. If I do chemotherapy, I can see it going down. Okay? That basically, there's a response to my therapy. But that's no guarantee the patient survives. I have an employee. This guy's about 50. I've known him from age of 16. He joined our college, graduated. He's been employed by us. I know him for almost now 40 years. And this guy, his younger brother, had blood cancer. And he came in, and then I told him, you just bring him to the clinic. We'll clear him probably in 3 weeks. But the family, the so everything, you know, all together, they went to one of the leading cancer hospitals in Chennai. They were there for 3 months. Then he came in after 3 months. The oncologist told him, we have cleared the cancer. Great news. And he was sending in dollars from the US. He was employed in our factory in the US. But unfortunately, your brother's body condition is such that he will not survive if I take him off the ventilator. The cancer is gone. You destroy the cancer and you also destroy the person. And in fact, they told him, we are waiting for you to clear switching off the ventilator. And they did it a day after he came in. So this is the kind of effect that we have with chemotherapy. And now let's look at, you know, data based on chemotherapy and what kind of impact it has. These are all the various cancers. And this is disease within 5 years of treatment. We're not talking about survival rate, we are talking about death rates here. Pancreatic cancer, 94% are deemed dead by the fifth year. Steve Jobs, one of the famous person saying, Manohar Parrikar. These are all people who had pancreatic cancer, had best of the world's diseases, I mean technologies available to them, they didn't survive. Liver cancer, 83.9. Lung cancer, 83.4. These two, I have cured myself without a problem. And we, a doctor and I, are very clear. These two are things that we can handle it. We will probably be talking about survival of almost 90%, maybe 10% of death rate. Then esophageal cancer, you look at it, and come down to the last one. Prostate cancer is 0.8%. So if you get treated or don't get treated, 99.2% of prostate cancer people will survive for 5 years. But why is allopathy testing men only for prostate cancer? Similarly, you talk about breast cancer for women, 10% is survival rate. I mean, so only 10% of the people die, 90% survive. So allopathy has picked up two of the easy fruits. They make everybody go through a test. They treat you, and phenomenally look at maximum treatment that goes through the hospitals is breast cancer and pancreatic cancer, which are easy to cure and good to charge on. Nobody's not talking about a test for pancreatic cancer. Nobody's talking about a test for liver cancer. Nobody's triggering all that, because if they took all that, they're not going to win. So I can't show a win. So it's more a political game. So this is what we have. I can show you one of the patients where she had four of the cancers simultaneously. She had lung, she had bones, she had, brains, and we have cleared her in 3 months. I'll show you that later. And this is again response and survival. Of the treatments that we have in allopathy today, these are all the responses of treatment. Beautiful response percentage, but the patient doesn't survive. Okay, so this is a reality that we face in cancer today. So this is what got us to think, can we do something better? And you know, you look at Thomas Edison's statement, it's really tongue-in-cheek. If there's a better way to do it, find it. So if we actually talk about alternate cure, everybody dumps on you. We have every day somebody telling us we don't know what we're doing. So it's a very interesting thing. That's why we don't even advertise, we don't even talk. We just left it. Today we have 40 patients coming in every day to get treated with us. We treat them twice a week. And all of that is walk-in with word of mouth. We have not asked for anybody. We have not conducted camps. The people who got cured have referred somebody else and the people are walking in. And Albert Sengoji is a scientist who discovered vitamin C. And he is a Nobel laureate. And he talks about discovery as being what everybody sees, but hasn't thought about something, a different aspect of it. And you look at his background, he's born in Hungary. He was chased by the Nazis. He came and settled in the US. And he has worked along with Linus Pauling, who actually talked about vitamin C as being cure for everything, who's two-time Nobel laureate. And then their work is based on another eminent scientist called Warburg, who talked about Warburg effect, who's also a Nobel laureate. So you have three people who have actually worked. And today I had the privilege of meeting a gentleman whose father worked with all the three. He's in this person is in Bangalore, and his father was a scientist who worked with all the three, and he was one of the scientists invited by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru to start Hindustan Antibiotics. So it was a big privilege today to have met him. And how do we talk about cancer? For us, it's mitochondria. I think all of you would have heard about mitochondria. This is a bacteria. A bacteria which did not belong in an animal. 1.5 billion years back, there was an accidental, you have living cells and you have bacteria. Okay? Whenever a bacteria goes into a living cell, it should kill the living cell. Or the living cell should destroy the bacteria for survival. This is the theory that we know. But 1.5 billion back, one bacteria went into a living cell and they suddenly became friends. Because this bacteria started throwing out electrons using the material within the cell. So the cell was able to synthesize food for the bacteria, and bacteria was able to throw out electrons, started giving energy. The moment you had energy in the cell started reverberating, it started moving, it split up, life started that way. That's what we hear about theory today. This is a book which was published in 2017, and you're looking at really cutting edge technology. So today, all of us, in every one of our cell, we have mitochondria. The only cell which doesn't have mitochondria, I believe, is a red corpuscle. Every other cell in the body has mitochondria. And depending upon the energy density of that cell, the number of mitochondria in each cell can vary from something like 100 to thousands. The brain cells have thousands of mitochondria within them, which is actually a bacteria which has a DNA apart from the DNA that you get from your mother and father. Your DNA, actually, you get two strings from mother and father and you're formed. The mitochondria is inherited from your mother. That's how the mitochondria travels, that bacteria travels in. The healthier that you have a mitochondria, healthier you are. Okay, and if your mitochondria is really active, you will not get any disease. The reason you get Alzheimer's is because your mitochondria in the brain is failing. The reason you get Parkinson's is because the mitochondria in your brain is failing. The reason you get heart disease is because your mitochondria in the heart is failing. In fact, there's a fantastic book by one doctor called Stephen Sinatra. He talks about ejection factor in a heart. Normally the heart has an efficiency, it's a pump. It has an efficiency of 70%. You can live with 50 to 70%, you're in good shape. Below 50, you start getting sick. That's when you start panting, you have this thing. And human being can live up to down to 20, maybe 15%, basically immobile. You'll be still working. And today, modern medicine has no way of fixing that except for a heart transplant. You look at the people who are going for a heart transplant, their mitochondria is dead, their heart is not pumping. There are four drugs, just give them, supplements actually. D-ribose, COQ10, carnitine, and magnesium. These four elements are given in adequate doses, the heart revives itself. And you have patients who go from 15% heart efficiency to 70%, 60% in a matter of 2 months. What have you done? You have given the mitochondria food to fire up the Krebs cycle. Basically, the mitochondria works on a Krebs cycle where vitamin C is involved, alpha lipoic acid is involved, all other kinds. It's a deep cycle. I can talk for hours on it. But these four material just gives the Krebs cycle something to kick on, your heart comes back. You don't need a bypass. You don't need a heart transplant, you're back on track. Similarly, liver transplant. You talk about failed livers, you put them on alpha lipoic acid, which is again a supplement. you would see the liver coming back to full firing within a matter of days. 7 to 8 days, you're back on liver. You don't need a liver transplant. Do people know about it? Yes. Why don't they talk about it? There's no money in it. It's not worth it for anybody to prescribe these medicines because you're not going to get much of money on it. So this is the kind of medicine that we're sitting with. Okay. So this is, we're talking about mitochondria. ATP is the main currency of energy in the body. Mitochondria makes ATP. It moves from ADP, diphosphate, to triphosphate when it earns an electron. And when it goes through the body, it throws out an electron, becomes diphosphate again. That's the energy which body picks up. So basically, it's a cycle going on your body. It's done by vitamin C as a major. Vitamin C is used up. CoQ10 is used up. And then you take alpha lipoic acid, it regenerates these characters, and they go on cycle. So as long as you have this energy, you are energetic. You'll be able to move. So now look at how do I get this mitochondria to work, okay? Vitamin C is a major, major factor to make my mitochondria work. That's why when Linus Pauling talked about vitamin C being cure-all, he was not talking about it as a medicine. Now today, everybody scoffs at him, saying that, how can one thing cure all? He was talking about it as a food or, you know, kind of a catalyst for the mitochondria. It makes the mitochondria really run well. So if your mitochondria runs well, you are perfectly okay. So this increases the ATP production, which is the currency of mitochondria. Apoptosis. What does mitochondria do? Mitochondria as a bacteria sits within a cell. If it sees a cell is a, you know, rogue, like for instance, a cancer cell, it just shuts itself down and kills the cell. The mitochondria decides whether a cell lives or cell does not live. Okay? So if you have a weak mitochondria, it's not able to take a decision. It's not able to force its will on the cell. That's when the cancer comes up. If you get very good mitochondria, you don't have to do anything for the cancer. Your body will kill the cancer cells. Okay? Then similarly, hydrogen peroxide is generated by vitamin C, and that kills the cancer cell. Cell differentiation. Vitamin C can make a difference between a rogue cell and a good cell. Will not kill a good cell, will kill a rogue cell. This is again on vitamin C. And for mitochondria, what are the things that I need to make energy on mitochondria? I need oxygen, I need alpha lipoic acid, I need CoQ10, acetyl-carnitine, ascorbate, and phospholipids. These are all the factors which basically mitochondria needs. And then we talk about vitamin C, you know, cancer, disease, whatever treatment we do. We use, there's a theory here. This is done by Albert Senghoji, the Nobel laureate. He talks about electron supply. I told you that ATP is a currency of the mitochondria which throws out electrons. Your entire body runs on electrons. What do you do when you do an ECG? You check the electrical impulse in your heart to show that your heart is functioning well or not. Basically, you're measuring the electric this thing. And what do an EEG. Finally, if somebody wants to certify a person dead, they do an EEG and see if there's any electrical activity in the brain. There's no electrical activity, the person is dead. So the definition that Senghoji did, if electron supply is high, you're healthy. It's low, you get sick. If it ceases, you're dead. Simple. Entire body runs on electrons. We are an electrical being. And these electrons are made by some bacteria which is living within us, which is not a part of us. Then ability to donate electron is a nutrient. Ability to deplete electrons is a toxin. What does potassium cyanide do? Takes away all the electrons. When you take potassium cyanide, it just depletes your body of electrons. Boom, you're dead. So this is a simple mechanism. So if you look at antioxidants, a nutrient, he just kind of, it's a paper that he's written, I didn't want to change anything. A lot of repetitions. All toxins are prooxidants, all prooxidants are toxins. So again, same thing he refers. Then toxins, prooxidants, electron depletion cause all disease and symptoms. You name the disease, It is caused by depletion of electrons in the body. Nutrients, antioxidants, electron repletion negate all disease and symptoms. So if I get more electrons into your body, I charge you, you're back on track. How do I charge you? I put more vitamin C into you, put more phospholipids into you, put CoQ10 into you, you're back and running. So this is a very simple thing. What we are doing is we are working at the fundamental cell level, setting the cell right. If the cell is set right, everything else happens by its own. It's God's will. I don't need to do much more than feed that particular area which is lacking in nutrients. It's very simple. I mean, this is where we are spending all our time. Unfortunately, the medical science have gone from scientists into pharmaceuticals. Into scientists employed by the pharmaceuticals, not pure scientists. Now we need the biologists to talk about mitochondria. How this is going to get back. I mean, that's where institutes like this will be something. I might get one scientist on this to start firing on it. Man, we got it solved. Very simple. Now, vitamin C is one of the most effective antioxidants. In fact, for snake bites, if a snake bites a horse, do they take it to a hospital to give it antivenom? No, they take 4 grams of vitamin C and give it a shot. The horse doesn't die. Look at veterinarian treatment. Snake bites for horses, you just inject 4 grams of vitamin C, one shot, boom. Works for us too. But we don't do it. We just go to the hospital, we'll look at antivenom, look everything. Really make a big hubbub. Actually, you can be cured just with shot of vitamin C. And glutathione is another one, which is also a very good antioxidant. And the prominent antioxidants we have, vitamin C, glutathione, vitamin E, vitamin A, alpha-lipoic acid, CoQ10, acetylcysteine, and silymarin. Then what method we do is we give intravenous injection of C from 25 to 100 grams over 4 hours. Okay? Now you look at RDA, recommended daily allowance of vitamin C is 50 mg for a person. 50 mg is nowhere near a scratch. 50 mg is to keep you dying from scurvy. You will not get scurvy. So whereas this is basically, you're looking at going up to 100 grams. The recommended dosage by Reardon Clinic, whom we work with, is 1 gram per kg of a person's body weight. The National Institute of Health actually goes up to 1.5 grams per kg of body weight. So for a person weighing 80 kilos, you can go up to 120 grams a day, no problems. And we then went and actually we said, okay, let's look at something else. I worked on this. We developed phospholipids, again, is an essential ingredient for the body and also for mitochondria. So we developed a drink based on phospholipids, vitamin C, lysine, and proline, which can take care of cancer, it can take care of your atherosclerosis. It's a fairly interesting concept. This drink we developed in 2012. And today I think we'll be serving all of you a pack of that. You can try, and if you want to take some home, you could do too. And basically phospholipids and glycanoids can repair cellular membranes by increasing the membrane fluidity. And by repairing these membranes, you can generate ATP. And basically the whole thing, mitochondria will be repaired. So basically, again, we're looking at mitochondria, we're giving it the fuel and the tools to repair itself. So IV administration is kind of crude in one way. Okay, whereas liposomal delivery is superior. Now we are developing some IVs which could be liposomal and where we can increase the efficiency. So that's something that we want to work on so that you can react much quicker to diseases that we have. And when you don't have an IV, you can drink, take it 4 to 5 packets a day, roughly about 8 to 10 grams of vitamin C by oral, which will also keep you at the same levels. So what's a liposome? It's a microscopic coverage of the spheres. And this we break down into nanoparticles. The process that we have, we are taking down to 50 nanometers, whereas most of the other guys do it at about 100 to 200 nanometers. We are using the same technology which is used for making inkjet inks, which are in picometers. So we are actually breaking it down to 50 nanometers, and we have fantastic efficiency based on this. This again, I'm talking about characteristics of liposomes. Then how we admit it, I can just run through this, okay. And we can put all kinds of things into the liposomes. We can give vitamin C, E, A, carotenoid, anything. And let me just talk about an example of two patients that we have cured. Okay, I'm not talking about keeping them at the same level. We're talking about an absolute cure. This patient is a patient with lung cancer. She was treated by a leading hospital for almost a year and discharged after that, saying that we have no more possible treatment. She was on a stretcher. She was brought to us on a stretcher. She could not move from where she was. She came in on a stretcher, and then you can see the lesions in the lung. And you can see all those dots are all cancer. The entire skeleton is full of metastasis. Okay, we treated her. Now she walks around. In fact, she's now bringing her husband to get treated. And you can come and talk to her. She's bubbling. She's full of energy. And she's no longer the patient that they thought it's not going to survive. We've cleared the entire lesions. She also had a brain met. That's also been cleared. And this is a PET scan. Now, nobody can say she's going to die of cancer. It's not there. Okay, this is a clean sweep. And Dr. Arul can talk about it. He's also going to talk something about it. And one more thing. This will be a little gruesome. But this is just to make the point. This person has cancer of the tongue, palate, and throat. Okay? And the normal procedure, you would cut out the palate, maybe cut out part of the tongue, and remove the voice box. Because the cancer is all over there. Right, that's or you burn it with radiation. Again, I mean, whether you burn it or you cut it out, you're doing the same. You're going to destroy that part. Right? We treated this guy. You see the next slide. You see the three dots there. Right? See the next slide. One is gone. Just one dot, kind of grayish now, not white. The next day, I mean, next time it's yellow. It's kind of gone crazy. And this is the last one. It's almost become, you know, really very yellow. And at home, he coughed and it just fell out. End of story. This took 7 days. All of 7 days. And guess what we use for curing him? Take a wild guess. Wait one. Yes, of course, but not the main ingredient. Take another guess. I mean, a lot of kids are there. No, it'll be very difficult to guess, okay? It is baking soda. Baking soda. Okay? Baking soda is something which can kill cancer like that. Because cancer is a fungus, it cannot survive in an alkaline environment. Baking soda kills. In your bathroom, if you have fungus, what do? Put some baking soda and clean it. It's gone. Right? So that's all you do. We got this guy to get 20 grams of baking soda and 100 milliliter of water and gargle, let it hit there and then drink a little bit. 7 days, it is gone. Another guy, he had colon cancer. Colon cancer, what happens with normal conventional treatment? You go to a doctor, do a radiation, do a colonoscopy, and then do a colonoscopy, remove your colon, put a bag, so you walk around the rest of the time with a bag where your waste collects. We did an enema with sodium bicarbonate, 3 days, gone. That's it. So, I mean, this is like sodium bicarbonate, you can do it at home. You don't need anything else, right? So, and if you drink Eno, forget it, I mean, somebody gets cancer, just give them eight glass of Eno a day. You change the body to alkaline. The moment it becomes alkaline, cancer cannot survive. End of story. Don't waste your time. Because these are things that we can do very simply and cure people. So this is what I wanted to just tell you on that. Then I'm just quoting somebody from 2,500 years back. Hippocrates, in whose name all the doctors take an oath, right? So he should know more than all the doctors. And he says, 2,500 years back, better not to apply any treatment in case of occult cancer. Occult cancer is where you can see the cancer coming out. For if treated, the patients die quickly. If not treated, they hold on for a long time. Which is true today too. So we don't listen to Hippocrates. We listen to everybody else. I mean, are we smarter? 2,500 is down. I mean, what kind of technology are we talking about? Right? So this is the conclusion of this. Chemotherapy does not eliminate breast, colon, or lung cancers. This has been documented for over a decade. Yet doctors use chemotherapy for these tumors. Why? You should ask them. When they tell you there's no proof for anything, you ask them, what is the proof that the drug that you're giving me, I want to see the data. I want to see the efficacy data on that. None of them would even know it because they only talk to the medical rep who actually told them what commission they will get. Don't quote me on that. Okay, so this is something which we find very interesting. So I thought we should give it to National Institute of Advanced Studies, and you should give us a lot more data to feedback on. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Everybody will be wondering how come an allopathic doctor jumped into integrative medicine. Basically, I lost three members in my family because of cancer. I've seen my grandmother, grandfather, and my mother. All three died of cancer in front of me. Being a doctor, I couldn't even give a quality of life. Forget about curing or prolonging the survival. But quality of life, I couldn't give for them. That's the main thing. Where I went in search, then I got about all these treatments, went around the world from Mexico to Japan, learned many things, then I brought it to our country. And that's how my journey started. Then after getting acquainted with our chairman, we thought, and because of his passion to develop this clinic, we started one in Pollachi. That's how the birth of Mirakle Wellness Clinic came into existence. So why was it established? It is a dream of our chairman. He is into research into vitamin C since 2004. Giving vitamin C to all the company employees, his known relatives, friends, and all, and he has seen very good results. And he was, when we discussed about all these things, then he asked me one day, can you come and join this? I readily agree. Where will I go other than this place? Where I will be recognized? So I thought the best decision in my life at this age. So I joined with him, and we have started this center in Pollachi. About liposomal vitamin C, he has done a lot of that, and he has spoken everything to you. This is our principle. We at Mirakle believe that the body has the ability to heal itself when the right conditions are established. We aim to establish those right conditions and correct them. See, here only we differ from other allopathic doctors. We don't treat the organs or the some other thing. We go to the cellular level. We treat only the cells. When the cells are treated and they become healthy, the tissue organs should be healthy. When the organs are healthy, the tissues will be healthy, then the whole body will be healthy. We go to the deep root cause by applying various techniques, including vitamin C and other modalities of our therapies. We do all these things in Mirakle, improve your lifestyle, then boost your biology, enhance your treatment with all natural things. It's a spacious space, natural greenery, all these things where patients enjoy. They don't feel at the hospital, they feel at home, at ease also. We have got a lot of therapies are into integrative medicine, which are not practiced by many centers in India. There are a lot of centers in India practicing integrative medicine. But all of them, they lack certain things. But here, we got everything under one roof. Like medical ozone therapy, high-dose vitamin C, intravenous antioxidants like glutathione, alpha-lipoic acid, Mayer's cocktail, external counterpulsation therapy for cardiac diseases, chelation therapy for heavy metal detoxification, hyperbaric ozone therapy, first time introduced in India for all diseases, pulsed electromagnetic therapy for joint pain, prolotherapy and PRP, platelet-rich plasma therapy for arthritis, ozone, FIR and NIR saunas, exercise with oxygen therapy, metabolic and functional medicine consultations also are there, where we assess your metabolism. Based on the metabolism, then we start treating the patients. With supplements, vitamin C, we don't give any medicines. We just supplement with nutrients, micronutrients. Cancer. This is everyone, as our chairman has put it, everything he has told about cancer. Proliferation with the invading local tissues and spread to distant areas. We used to say cancer is a metabolic disorder. It is not a genetic disorder as we have all been led to believe. Maybe 5% genetics, 95% is not genetics, it's purely metabolic. That's why Dr. Thomas, I took this slide from the Dr. Thomas Seyfried book. You can see here, sir, normal cells give birth to normal cells. Tumor cells give birth to tumor cells. In normal cytoplasm, if you put a tumor nucleus, the birth is only normal cells. But if the cytoplasm is fully invaded with cancer cells, and if you put a normal nucleus, the birth is a tumor cell. So we are correcting your terrain. When the terrain is perfect and healthy, nothing is going to attack us. Here is why we differ with the main oncologist. It's not genetic. Just my father, mother got it, I need not get it. If I maintain my terrain properly, we go to the third part only. Yeah. Statistics. Number of people with every year new cancer patients, all these things. Before the age of 75 years, 9.81 female, all these. As our chairman has told in his previous slide, he was talking about prostate cancer. I would like to tell you one thing. If you, someone else known to us have prostate cancer, it's better not to touch it. The cancer will die along with him. But if we do any meddling activity like biopsy or all these things, he will die because of cancer. Better don't check PSA. That's the thing I'm telling everyone. So, what is the current state of cancer treatment? Procrustes, have you heard, sir? Anybody? It's a Greek mythology. Procrustes. He who stretches. See, this Greek mythology, there was one guy by name Smith. He used to have a hostel like this in the highway, long highways, where the strangers can come in, get a sleep, and they can leave next day morning to the place. But he used to, he kept a house by the side of the road where he offered hospitality by passing strangers who were invited in for a pleasant meal and a night's very special Procrustean bed. What is that bed? He described it as having the unique property of that its length exactly matched whomsoever lay down upon it. Whether he is short or tall, it will match. What Procrustes didn't volunteer was the method by which this one size fits all was achieved. How? See, guests too small stretch their limbs. Guests too tall chop off their limbs. This is how the chemotherapy is today. This is how chemotherapy. Force others to conform to rules or ideas. Some white skin from some country will enter into our country. He will talk about new medicine. They will say FDA approved. And our doctors start writing from next day. Because we are glorified sellers for the pharmaceutical company. That's a sad thing. So we fight through our personalized support like high dose vitamin C, medical ozone and hyperbaric ozone, sodium bicarbonate, which is our, what to say, you got so. See, we had last week, sir, we had a new case, adenocarcinoma of the rectum. He came from a reputed hospital from Coimbatore, severe pain, Then, okay, we all suggested, we discussed. Then we gave him a rectal flush using baking soda, sodium baking. Next day he was laughing. Sir, pain is gone. I'm able to sit. If you come to, you can see those patients there, sir, lot of patients. Then we do IPT also, sir. IPT is something which is new to our country. I was trained in this in Mexico, where at times we need to give some low dose chemo, 1/10, where there is no side effect or adverse effect, something like that. We just pump in some insulin, bring the sugar below 40, then we give the 10% of the dose. So it kills all the cancer cells. Cancer feeds on sugar. When you give insulin, the sugar value comes down. So the cancer will be starving for food. It will be searching, where's the food, where's the food. That time we pump in 1/10 of the dose of the chemo plus glucose, dextrose. So everything will go in and it will kill the cancer cells. No side effect, nothing. They will walk in and walk out the same day. Not like 3 days, 21-day cycle, 6-day cycle and all. That's also we introduced for the first time in the country. Then we use mistletoe, it's a helixol, it's a German brand, herbal injection from Germany, which is also gives an immune modulator actually. It improves the immunity. Hypothermia through NIR sauna, we do give the temperature. There was a doctor by name, I forgot, he used to say, give me fever, I will cure cancer. So whenever fever comes, you need not take dolo 650 or paracetamol. And fever is not due to the deficiency of these two drugs. Fever is coming because you're coming low on immunity. Just improve your immunity, you're getting fever. Control it, take rest, drink a lot of fluids, it will go off. And immune cells, immunity will rise. Unless otherwise it's a malaria, viral or typhoid. That's the thing. Like curcumin, ALA, resveratrol, all of these things, we give natural probiotics. Then some cases you can see here. This is what our chairman showed there last time, the lung case with the skeletal metastasis. Here I'll show you about the same thing. You can see the brain, sir. The primary was in the left lung. They gave chemo, around 6 cycles of chemo and radiation. After 3 months, it spread to the right lung. Then slowly it went into the brain, then to the skeletal bone. Then the patient was brought to us as he told about the same stretcher, all these things. We start with vitamin C and many other sodium bicarbonate, all these drugs. See the tumor, sir, on the brain, on the left top. Vitamin C, vitamin K also we used, medical ozone, bicarbonate, nebulizations, strict diet control, macro and micronutrients. Macro is nothing, carbohydrate, fat and protein. Micro is nothing, is about selenium, zinc, all these nutrients only we gave. See, it is gone. Totally gone. And the oncologists were shocked. His jaw dropped down. And this is the report, how it came and all. I just attached it, where the result. This is a case of carcinoma tongue. This lady from Kerala had a tumor in the tongue. She was advised to do a partial removal of the tongue. Imagine the quality of life, how it will be. 2 months of treatment with IV vitamin C, sodium bicarbonate gargle and medical ozone, it has reduced. She started drinking at least liquids now, little bit, all these things. Eczema, 30 years, seen all major doctors in England. Nobody can cure that. Nobody is able to cure him, this guy. One-month treatment with hyperbaric ozone, elimination diet, and micronutrients. You can see this. Totally gone. Here, if you go to the doctors, dermatologists, they will start putting you on steroids, multiple creams, which is not going to work. Whatever happens in the gut, it is expressed in the skin. If your gut is clear, everything will be clear. That's why we concentrate on the gut, mainly on the gut. Psoriasis, this guy came to us, all these lesions, 24th January 2019, sorry, T2 the hyperbaric ozone, sauna, chelation, IV vitamin C, elimination diet, micronutrients, no ESD can see. And he's still coming on and off, every month he comes until it's completely good, because he has got some gut problems also. So first we treated the gut problem, we concentrated on the gut, then only we came into the skin. With that itself, he is getting tremendous improvement with this. IBS, the lady suffering from chronic irritable bowel syndrome, 40 years, 5 to 6 times per day, cannot eat anything apart from few specific foods, cannot go anywhere because of this problem, fear. Then we did organic acid testing. There was a gut metabolism was completely shattered. This test was done. We found out all the bad bacteria and the good bacteria, the metabolism was not correct. We corrected that. Now we put her on glutathione also, pre and probiotics with certain micronutrients. No allopathic medications, right? We are very sure, no allopathic medication. Now, 1 month of treatment, the frequency of stools has come down to 2 times per day, she is able to tolerate foods. So prevention is better than cure. Now, everyone has to be careful about this. We go to the hospitals to do master health checkup. Anybody tested for CRP? Sir, you all go for master health checkup? Huh? You? Have you seen the test by name CRP done in your lab? CRP? C-reactive protein? Huh? Yeah. What would they say if it is high? What do they say, sir? This is the main inflammation, sir, the main root cause for cancer and all other diseases. Most of the hospital, they don't do CRP. Only few. Even if it is high, they don't know what to do for that. They need only lipids, LFTs, all these things. Then they ask you to go for treadmill. Treadmill is the gateway for bypass. Yes, it's a gateway for bypass. So that's a thing. So we concentrate on this. Whenever a patient walks into Mirakle, we do a complete metabolic profile blood test where we assess the metabolism of your body. We assess your gut, we assess your metabolism. Based on that, we plan your treatment. We take you also into confidence. We disclose everything. We are transparent, no hidden agenda, nothing. So like that, we approach this. Chronic inflammation is only part of your body. Be it chronic dental infection, rheumatoid arthritis, you are prone to developing cancer. So you should watch this, CRP. Next time when you go to a clinic, when you do a preventive test, ask them to do CRP. You educate them, they don't know. That's the thing. Check your levels and take measures to bring down inflammation. Inflammation is the main root cause for all illnesses. You should be very careful in this. All disease begins in the gut, Hippocrates. This is the leaky gut, we say. Drugs, lot of antibiotics, another thing. Whenever you go to the doctor, if they prescribe antibiotics, please don't take antibiotics. Go for curcumin, the best antibiotic in the world. Curcumin, turmeric extract. That's the best antibiotic in the world. Never take antibiotics. This is the thing. For leaky gut, you should get tested for this leaky gut. Gut is supposed to be like this. It should be like this, not like this. It should be like this. That's the problem. Whole foods are better than juices. That's another thing. You should eat a rainbow of diet. That's the best thing. Full spectrum, nutrition for a full spectrum life. Go for the full rainbow. You should balance your hormones when you age, both male and women. don't go for synthetic hormones, we do bioidentical hormones, where we bring in equality. So nothing, no side effects, nothing. One of the most important root cause, again, influenced by our diet and lifestyle. As sir said, right time eating, right food, minimal exercise will keep everything in balance. That's it. Xenoestrogens present in broiler chicken, mercury present in seafood, hydrocarbons present in deep fried and grilled foods. These are the worst offenders for our health. We should be very careful in this. De-stress, main thing, stress. This has to be done, sir. Your blood sugar levels won't come down, your inflammation won't come down, and hormones will behave. Many stresses in our life, but it's how you reflect to it that matters. There are people who just walk away casually, whatever happens. But there are people, for small things, they will jump from top to bottom. Four steps to a healthy life: eat well, move well, live well, and sleep well. Trust. Here I want to say, sir, at Mirakle Wellness Clinic, we try to develop this trust right from the point of entry of the client to our clinic. We disclose everything to them. We are transparent. We don't hide anything, because once it is broken like this glass, it can't be the same. We are very careful in that, right from our staffs, right from the reception area to my room to the consultant room. We tell what's happening. This is the way we operate. This is the grams of vitamin C you are taking today. This is the injection. This contains this. This contains that. There are some, you may experience something, all these things. We try to put ourselves, we open the book. We don't hide anything. We see to that this is maintained at every level. Then only the health healing comes faster also. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manickam. Thank you, Dr. Arul. And if you have any questions, kindly raise your hand, identify yourself.
Good evening, I'm Harini. I'm a PhD scholar here. I really love the presentations. My only question is, if we are introducing vitamin C into the system, I don't know, I could be wrong, but are there going to be side effects in the long run? As in, because vitamin C in the long run can also be...
See, vitamin C, by and large, there's nothing which can happen with vitamin C. Okay, the toxicity load for any drug there is, so vitamin C, there's hardly any toxicity load. And the amount that we're using is about 1 to 1.5 grams per kg, as I said. At this level, there's nothing happens. And I've seen people taking up to 2 to 3 grams a day. Doesn't happen, one thing. And the big difference between why we are giving vitamin C is that on the planet, there are only 4 animals which do not make vitamin C themselves. Okay, the vitamin C molecule, if you look at it, it's the exact same formula as sugar with one OH transposed. Okay, vitamin C and sugar almost have the same kind of molecular formula. And almost all species, dogs, pigs, lions, and everybody else makes their own vitamin C. In fact, lambs can go up to 4 grams per kilo of body weight. They, when they have infection, they make their own vitamin C. The human being, guinea pig, and chimpanzee, I think these three, lost the gene to make vitamin C. I think our diet was so rich in vitamin C, on the selection process and evolution, we seem to have lost the gene of making vitamin C. That's why basically we have to supplement ourselves. So we have not seen any toxicity. Of course, a lot of doctors say, we say kidney stones. In fact, we say to take vitamin C, your kidney stone goes away. So in fact, there is a Harvard study with 8,000 nurses which proves otherwise. So there are enough studies to prove that vitamin C has no negative connotation. There's no saturation level. So we have the juice outside, so people can just pick it up. It's basically 1 gram of vitamin C in a Tetra Pak, which is liposomal. So it's equal to, in terms of strength,
40 tablets of selen. It's equal to 20 grams. It's actually only 1 gram. The efficacy is almost equal to 40 tablets of selen.
I've heard, I've started taking curcumin, the capsules, without getting assessed for inflammation and all. And just like you said, vitamin C. Can we just go out and start taking it, or do we need to get ourselves assessed to see how much do we need?
For vitamin C, madam, or curcumin?
Both.
Oh, no need to assess for all these things. Just check your inflammation.
Take it for inflammation,
yeah,
for pain,
for inflammation,
muscle pain.
Then you can take a regular dose.
Regular, like
the,
I take
one
gram, capsule
grams,
a day.
3 grams of vitamin C a day.
How many grams?
3 grams.
3 grams.
One capsule contains only 500 milligrams, linen C and selen.
Okay, so I should take 3 grams per day.
Per day.
Okay. And vitamin C also, can one just start, go out and take it, or should one get assessed on how much one
No,
needs?
No need to assess. You can just take it. Nothing to it.
Okay. One tablet it contains, right? So do we need to take, I mean, do she need, does she need to take 6 tablets, or we know that oranges or lemons have vitamin C. So take that lime juice, it's more natural.
But you have to take, consume tons of oranges and say.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Which is not possible.
Oh, okay. Fine. So
If you take 500 milligrams of lime juice or selen, only 5% will get absorbed. 95% will be thrown out.
Oh, okay. Sure.
So liposomal is best. Anything in liposomal form, curcumin, vitamin C, that's the best.
Is it a tablet? That
no, liquid.
Liquid, okay. So I have a question. I mean, I don't have words to express the greatness of the talk over here. I'm sorry, but you are working in the field of education also when you were introduced. So just I would like to listen to that also, not now, but in some other talk maybe. But okay, my question related to this is that you talked about the metabolism versus genetics, right?
Yeah.
So how much of it is genetic and how much of it is metabolism? Because the analogy
5% genetics, 95% metabolic.
Okay. And DNA is really not the answer of who we really are, right?
It all depends.
Blueprint and all that.
It all depends upon the terrain, sir.
The terrain means I didn't get
the that. Cytoplasm, how your body, the field.
Okay.
The body, the cellular level, okay. I'm talking about the cellular level. Okay. That cell should be healthy. Right. It also breathes.
Okay.
It also excretes. The toxins has to be sent out. The nutrients has to be taken in.
Okay.
Further, the cell membrane should be permeable. For all these things, we need all these vitamins, all these things.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
This is about 1 gram of liposomal C and 3 grams of phospholipids, 0.5 gram of lysine and 1/4 gram of proline. So this is what we have. You can take as many as you want. It's outside. I take about 2 a day, easy. And I mean, you can take as much. I mean, one minimum. We have not marketed it yet, ma'am. So, in fact, we're just selling it through our clinic now. We're still working on getting it perfect. Because earlier, we started with sugar. Now, we're done without sugar. I think we're going to standardize this, and then probably another 3 to 6 months, we should be out.
Since we are talking about vitamin C, and especially in my case, even if a few drops of lemon, you know, it creates havoc. Because I get this kind of acid attack. I can't even have a lemon. So, I'm just thinking, on what is the process and which kind, what kind of vitamin C I can intake when it is not creating a too much of problem?
No madam, you should check your gut first.
Okay.
That is the main thing. Not the lemon is not creating havoc in your body. The gut is the one rejecting it. Why it is rejecting, we have to find out.
Okay.
And you can take tons of lemon, don't it?
All right. Yeah, because whenever, I mean, if I
do you have a bloating abdomen after food?
No.
Belching?
No.
Nothing. Okay.
It's just kind of acidity. I mean, sometimes it's
something
severe attack that my whole mouth will get blisters and it will, it will remain for 2-3 days.
Check your gut first. Check your gut.
Okay. I did endoscopy and everything.
No, that
and
will not tell anything.
Works, yeah.
Endoscopy, don't go for endoscopy. Just go for the smaller thing. Okay. IgG, IgE, you do these tests. From that, you will know what's happening. All whether right. your stomach is properly secreting hydrochloric acid or not.
Mm-hmm.
Everything counts. Why go to top?
Yeah, because doctor wants me to.
No, they will go do. To the top. They will tell you anything to do. They have the instrument, they have to use it.
Okay. Yes.
They have the instrument, they have to use it.
Yeah, we have to trust them because since I'm not a doctor, I have to trust them, you know.
That's what I'm telling. Last week, I sent one patient in Chennai. An 18-year-old girl came to me with the right hypochondrial pain. So I suspected, considering her age, I thought it's it should be appendix.
Okay.
So better we check. I told her they wanted me to do an ultrasound. I said, okay, go ahead with ultrasound. You know what the report came? The radiologist was so clever. He just sighed. The impression he told me, due to the overlapping of the transverse colon and the lower part of the cecum on the appendix, we are not able to confirm the diagnosis. I kindly request her to go for CT abdomen. See how they pull you in.
Yeah, thank you.
That's
thank you so much.
Don't go for endoscopy. Then they will say you have ulcer.
Yeah, that is
then
what that's telling.
Then
that
they'll
that
put
that is
you.
What going
ah,
through.
That's
you
what
mean. So, I mean, I have gone through so many problems. When I had appendix, I was being treated like a gynae. For a year, I was treated as I have a gynae problem. Then I went to Duke, and very next day, the doctor said, no, it's an appendix.
Yeah.
It got operated.
That's what I did.
So,
I am Vishwanath. I'm a postdoc here. I found your talk interesting, but I didn't find any statistics of, you know, how many cases were actually, you know, cured or
just now we started. We are just 1 year old.
Okay.
And we are just documenting it.
Right.
Right now we were discussing in the afternoon.
Right.
From this January till this July.
Right.
We had around 460 new patients.
Okay.
Out of which 43 were completely cured.
Right.
We had 13 deaths.
Okay.
And 256, around 80, they opted out because for various reasons they couldn't come. The rest are coming and we are following them. They have all clinical improvement is good. And these 13 deaths, all end-stage patients, stage 4 they came.
Right.
So our percentage is hardly 3.
Okay, so how does this compare with regular allopathic or chemotherapy treatment?
Regular allopathy, 90% death. We have only 3% death.
Within the same time frame?
Yeah, not time frame.
Okay.
See, we don't go so aggressive. We give the patients their lenity. They can come. But we tell them, come weekly twice or thrice. Do meditation, stick diet, keep walking, de-stress yourself. Finish. Your body will heal on your own, sir. We are not doing anything. 70% is you, 30% only we.
Good evening, sir. I'm Anandi from EC department. I have two questions, actually. Do you have any treatment for gallstones? Is the one. And the second one is, one of my relatives is suffering from dialysis stage 4 or something.
Kidney.
So is there, yeah, kidney.
No, that is we can't do.
You
dialysis
don't
in stage.
Ah,
is difficult.
Okay.
Gallstones, you can try homeopathy.
Homeopathy. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Dinesh Srivastava, let me ask you that nasty question. Have you tried to publish your results in medical journals?
No, actually, whatever treatment we are doing, there are thousands of articles on it, on medical journals. We are not picking up anything. There's no treatment that we are doing which we have developed ourselves. Okay, so what we are doing is every treatment we do, there is a validated medical process. So you can Google it. You will see PubMed, hundreds of articles on vitamin C. In fact, I am in touch with the National Institute of Cancer in Bethesda, National Institute of Health. The lead scientists there are working with me. So there are a lot of papers on vitamin C. They've said it proves cure in cancer. But nobody wants to take it for FDA approval because there's no money in it. But otherwise, there is a lot of literature which is talking about cure of cancer, how many, what's the percentage. All that, you can just Google it, you will see thousands of articles on glutathione, you will see it on vitamin C, you will see it on ALA, you will see right now the latest one which has come is something called PQQ, which basically talks about reversing Alzheimer's, then you're talking about Parkinson's, you're talking about building new mitochondria, which is, mitochondria is not, so far there was nothing to build new mitochondria. This PQQ actually starts building up new mitochondria, which reverses Parkinson's and Alzheimer's, which is unbelievable.
And all these are over-the-table supplements. We are not looking at any medicines. Everything you can buy in Amazon. So it is generally certified as being safe, grass, and it is absolutely things which you can buy off the table.
Yeah. So what will WHO say? And will it certify it?
No, I'm just curing. No, there's nothing. You can buy it across the table. It's just like buying vitamin C. Vitamin C cures it. You can buy PQQ, you can buy COQ10, you can buy magnesium stearate. Everything is good for you. What unfortunately happens is, your doctors don't prescribe you to take supplements. They ask you to take drugs, which is what needs approval. These things are all natural food which don't need approval at all. We don't prescribe anything which needs an approval.
So for you only, since you asked these questions, I have one senior doctor by name, Dr. Rabindranath. He's from New Zealand. He's a senior nephrology professor. He was a senior nephrology professor from Madras Medical College. I know him well. He was practicing in New Zealand. He came out to India 4-5 years back. He wanted to start ozone for renal failure patients. So he went in search of, he got a hospital in Pondicherry, East Coast Hospital, run by Dr. Murugesan. He's a junior for him. So he started a center there with ozone, EBO, extracorporeal blood ozonation and oxygenation. He came to me, he was with me for a week, he learnt everything. His age is 77, senior professor. He started that therapy in East Coast Hospital, giving ozone for small, small things. Ultimately, one day, there was a patient in ICU with hepatic coma. The relatives could not afford to pay for the treatment and the patient is on coma. So they want to take him against medical advice to their home, just see him die without anything because he is in coma. So this doctor told them, I will try ozone on you. Why not? Last try. Anyway, you're going home. Let me try. You don't pay for it. So he gave an EBO. Yusuf, I'm telling you, EBO, extracorporeal blood ozonation. 1 hour procedure. After that, the guy stood up. He wrote a big article. He sent it to the top journals. None of them published.
Thank you for a very interesting talk, for taking time and sort of talking here. I had a question on, can you talk a little bit about, I mean, generally there is this, beat all these naturally available formulations, curcumin, vitamin C, magnesium, you mentioned things that don't need approval. There is a concern about bioavailability and the fact that, I mean, the joke I've heard and the concern I've heard is it makes for very expensive urine. A lot of things get rejected and you pay a lot for it. You consume it, but most of it gets excreted. So can you talk a little about bioavailability and how to take it in a form that is absorbable, all of these things that you mentioned?
Okay, I mean, now you actually got my goat. See, I call doctors ill-trained mechanics. Okay, what are they taught? Is that what is the drug and for what disease that can be given? Okay, this, let's say you take about a doctor who's about 50 years old today. He passed out 25 years back. This guy read his last medical book for his exam 25 years back. After that, he's not read. I've talked to some other doctors. When I talk to him about this drug, he says, no, the medical rep didn't tell me about this. Why don't you ask the medical rep to... I said, sir, this is not available for medical reps. This is available in journals. He said, no, I don't have time to read the journals. I wait till the medical rep comes to me. So what happens today is a doctor waits for the medical rep to come to him and then will do this. That is point number one. Secondly, they're all taught cliches. The young doctor is taught what we call Tamil, Koli Amtharadu, you know, to catch a hen. When you catch a hen, don't let go, right? So you walk in with a cardiac condition into the hospital, immediately say, no, you got a 3 blocks. We need to admit you right now and put stents on you. He'll say, I'll go for a second opinion. Or I want to wait. Then they'll call his wife. You sure your Mangalsutra wants to be on your neck? If he's walking out of the door, he might collapse. He's a walking time bomb. And what does the wife do? Catches her husband by the collar and puts him in the bed. No husband has a right to, guts to fight with the wife. He quietly lies down. Right? they will not let you go outside. The way they push you is that you need to get treated right now, this minute, and you need to get either a stent or a bypass, don't go out. I mean, they literally push you, and they are taught that way. That's the way that they are taught. And this expensive urine is another story that they are taught. Okay, now I am giving you a 50 paisa vitamin C. Okay, you are going to just waste 50 paisa. They give a $7,000 antibiotic. It fails. Which is more expensive? You know, you basically are, these are all things that they want to bully you, saying that, okay, this is an expensive urine. You're only trying, I mean, these are all cliches. You're a walking time bomb. Similarly, on cancer, they say this we can't do. So these are all things which they've been taught, and they really work on it. So you need to go beyond it. And there are, you just need to read. I mean, right now, whatever I've said is based on research. You can Google it. You'll get documents and papers written on it. And for instance, on cancer, you know, the Fushikawa, the nuclear disaster in Japan, where the nuclear thing blew up, and for 100 kilometers it's radiated, they evacuated, Fukushima, the latest one. So in that, there were 18 guys working as, it is called TAPCO, operators in that plant. They are the people who operate that plant. Once it blew up, somebody had to go back in and shut the plant. Who will go and shut it now? These 18 were asked to go back. So, they didn't volunteer. I mean, the Japanese duty is that they have to go. And Amritananda Mai was apparently in Tokyo that time. They had a dilemma. The family was saying, you're not going in. You're walking into an open nuclear reactor, which is spewing radiation. There's no way you're going to survive. You will get secondary cancer. You will die in a number of years, right? So they went and met Amritananda Mai. She said, listen, this is your karma. Because there's nobody else in the world who knows that plant like 18 of you guys. You have to go back and you shut it down. They went back, they shut it down. None of them died. None of them got cancer. Because they were, in fact, there are papers, Japanese Defense Agency have done this. They were all put on 3 grams of liposomal vitamin C, prior and after. And the guys who took prior never got gene degradation. The guys who didn't get prior got gene degradation. And when they were given vitamin C, the gene recovered. So there is papers written where you have high radiation, people under radiation have recovered, the genes have recovered, the cancer scores have gone down. There's a clear paper on it. I have the paper with me. I mean, there's a lot of scientific data. It's not that it is not there, but people don't want to look at it. So there is enough scientific data. In Japan, they do recommend, there are 700 doctors, allopathic doctors, who prescribe vitamin C for radiation. So it's there.
Hello sir, my name is Dr. Yusuf and I'm practicing in Bangalore. I want to tell you my personal story. In 2012, my father had a heart attack in January, in 2012. So in the renowned hospital in Bangalore, they told he will live for only 2 days. He has to be operated immediately. So I was convinced, being a doctor also, I was convinced because I was afraid that my father has to live. And my father didn't believe and he threw everything. He told, immediately I want to get discharged. So I started seeing for an alternatives from there. So we met Arul sir, and because of him, we have learned many things. Dr. Shalin Berger and Dr. Lahodini, we have trained under him because of Arul sir. Yeah, for many Indian doctors. And now we have treated almost all the cases from reputed hospitals, like kidney, right, renal failure, 9.5 creatinine, we came to 0.99. And in the same hospital I gave my resume and I told I want to practice in this hospital because I want to get a name and we want to help the patients. So what the reputed hospital told, see, if we give you a chance, we have to shut down our hospital because we have many things to do and you don't recommend the they told that if you do this, we have to shut down the hospital, and you are telling that you are specialized in everything, cardiac, renal, and all everything, every specialty. So if you give a chance, then we have to be in this one. So sorry, we can't give. And after that, I approached one more hospital. Recently, I'm telling. And in the same thing they told in the same, but I'm getting many patients. But I wanted a specialty hospital. But I didn't got the opportunity to serve as a functional medicine doctor.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for this lecture. My name is Rakesh Kumar and I am working on indigenous healing tradition. So my question is that you talked about the disease, and my basic question, how do you identify the disease if some person will come as a first hand to you? You've never been to the allopathic, you didn't talk about the mechanism of how do you identify the disease, what kind of disease, if you negate the allopathic testing and all other things. And the second thing is, how do you decide the mechanism of diagnosis? Like what you were told, that vitamin C, whatever this, but when you, how you decide the dose or the treatment methodology, can you talk about this?
Yes, sir. We do liquid biopsy, not solid biopsy, taking the tissue from the organ and sending it to the pathology lab. We do liquid biopsy, that is, we do a complete metabolic profile of your blood. That will tell many stories. Most of the diseases will come out in this. What you are having now, what you are going to get in future, all these things will be known through the test. From there, we take it off with supplements, ozone and vitamin C and other things. No side effects, nothing. Simple. This, we apply functional medicine to it. Functional medicine is something new to India. It is very well practiced in US. It is becoming very popular. Not yet stepped into our country. It will take another 20 years to come. We are ahead of India in practicing functional medicine. We are only few, including Yusuf and all, I am telling. Only 12 doctors in India practicing this medicine.
Tradition, the local tradition they used to do in the tribal community and all. How do you see them, their approach and their mechanism of diagnosis?
See, a lot of those are good. Okay, the first instance of vitamin C was found when one Red Indian guy boiled pine needles in water and gave it to somebody to cure scurvy. Okay, that is the first recorded incidence of vitamin C curing scurvy. So the tribal knowledge of eating herbs, of even today, the best thing for your liver is Live 52, which is from a herb. There is nothing in allopathy equal to Live 52. So a lot of this we lost. The British destroyed it. They destroyed our journals. They destroyed our practices. They said anything which is not allopathic is heathen. In fact, you'd be surprised. Until 1977, if you practice Ayurveda, you can be jailed. If you practice Unani, you'd be jailed. If you did homeopathy, it is okay. It is white man's medicine. So these two, and in 1977, one mad guy called Rajnarayan, who defeated Mrs. Gandhi and became the health minister, he's the person who started college on Siddha, college on Ayurveda, and college on Unani, and said these are equivalent to MBBS. You can practice this. It became legal in the first Janata government in 1977. Until 1977, any of these practices were banned. And now Ayush is again coming back. So you would see a lot of changes coming in, a lot of the traditional. In fact, traditional medicine is a discourage. If you did that, you would go to jail. So now you would see it coming back.
Medicine, when you talk about the traditional medicine, in the sense of Ayurveda, Siddha, Unani, all the codified medical system, but when you talk about the tribal medical system, there is no codified. Their knowledge is transferred by the oral tradition. So how do you justify this?
What is the qualification? Your university degree, does it give you knowledge?
No, I'm not talking about that. I'm not negative. I'm working on indigenous.
No. What I'm saying is, MBBS, they teach you something which they know, could be wrong, but they give you a chapa. Right? So, I don't think, now you look at turmeric. India got a patent on turmeric. Right? America tried to patent it. We went and defended it, saying that we got so much of this thing. So, you have so many herbs, so many formulations. Trifala. Look at Trifala. Trifala is a combination of three condiments which cures so many things. And you look at Nadi. You know, you go to any Ayurveda practitioner, he doesn't do any diagnosis, not even the blood analysis. Just catches your hand, listens to you and will tell you what you have. They basically just interpret your heartbeat. So these are all sciences which we have lost. We have to revive all that. We have to pull it out, those practitioners we have to get. So we are actually in a process of transition. Hopefully we'll document all this and say, okay, these are all valid. We need to defend it. We shouldn't give it up ourselves saying that, okay, I know an allopath is more qualified than I am.
Documentation, you have also to take help from the allopathic test only, no?
No. Why?
Then what is the methodology? How will make people believe?
No, no, that is up to you. See, right now, we are not looking at anybody who believes. Somebody tells me, I believe in allopath, I tell him, take a walk. I don't want to deal with somebody who doesn't believe me. You think I'm going to cure you, we are happy to deal with you. If you think I'm not going to cure you, the worst thing that I have is a Dr. Thomas. Because then you can never satisfy him, no? So you should be either believe, that's what doctor was saying, trust. See, if there's no trust, there's no relationship even between a husband and wife or friends, whatever. You need to have the basic trust to move. That trust has to be there before you can start treating.
Okay, thank you.
Every system has its own advantages, sir. We have to take it. So,
okay.
Doesn't even have to hold your nadi. It is all his intuition and he uses that without any contact, okay? So, can you cultivate that in a doctor, like a course or something?
Okay, the Russians have got something called Krillian photography. Right? You talk about Krillian photography. I had a friend of mine who was studying in an institute called Brook Institute of Photography in California. And her job was to take a Krillian camera, get permission from people who are dying, and sit there and then take photograph as they die. And she wanted to capture the soul leaving the body. And she's got those kind of photographs. So if you're looking at Krillian photography, that is actually defining an aura. Supposing you have the ability to read the aura, he doesn't need to touch you. If you have that ability to read the aura, he will just look at you and tell you you're wrong. But okay, that is something which we have no idea of. We need to learn that. We've forgotten all that. These are things we need to recover out. So there is a scientific Krillian photography. There is this aura reading, but that is something we need to define.
Sir used to tell me, in colleges, you may get degree, but you won't get skill.
Let me start with thanking both Dr. Manickam and Dr. Arul for being with us. It's a different evening for us. This is not a discussion that we normally had so far in this this lecture hall. So let's give them a big hand for being with us. And let's also wish them well as they continue their path and expand their focus both nationally and internationally. And then good news should spread for the rest of the world.